welcome back to Sinews of War. In the previous episode, we sallied out against Savoy's siege screen at Paris. They used cavalry to inflict heavy losses on our line, but when eventually overcome, our own cavalry did the same right back to them, and after a grinding battle, we were eventually victorious and Savoy were pushed back. In the East Indies, we had a disastrous order resolve, which meant we lost the entire trade theatre all of a sudden. So we lost a lot of lives and a lot of income, not good for the East India Company. Some good news though was that we took Hispaniola from an inferior Spanish force thanks to Nassau, and we moved immediately on to start attacking Cuba. But before any of that, back over in Europe, I was doing what I thought was a sneaky attack on some Spanish industry, but it ended up skirmishing its way into a battle as the enemy came in to stop my units getting close to their town. I was micromanaging the two militia units I had available to slowly take out the enemy's units one by one, and now we're just left with a general and a pike unit left chasing us around the battlefield. When God first told me that I was to bring his word to an exotic land, he did not tell me whether I would be successful. I think that was a deliberate choice to ensure that I, as a servant selected for his personal scrutiny, would perform my duties to him with all the fervor I could draw from his presence. Now that I have found my mission to be fruitful, it brings great relief, for I know the Lord's blessing remains firmly upon me. And that blessing I shall need, for in all of India there are uncountable souls bound to the mob of false gods thrust upon them by their deceitful masters. When I feel the shepherds I have borne into the trust of the East India Company are sufficient to meet the spiritual needs of Ceylon, I shall make my way into the subcontinent. That shall be the darker time, the time of much threat and temptation, and the time when I make the Lord proud of his decision to choose me as his messenger. What untold evils await? What myriad lies will combat my pure and holy intent? The questions are too much for one soul to bear. But the Lord lifts his fair share always, bringing me through each day towards the light of his salvation. The partnership of this humble servant and his benevolent master will clear the path for all to follow, light the beacon atop the gates of heaven, and see that the devil's drink of souls runs dry before his mischief brings about the great calamity. So our game of cat and mouse is continuing, and you'll remember I split my two units of militia up, one being pursued by pikes, the other being pursued by the enemy's general, and here I seem to get a chance to fire on the enemy's general. He's hesitant to make an attack against my militia unit, so we're now basically trying to fire at them, but we have these agonizing moments where the men take a very long time to make that decision. By the time they eventually get the volley off, they can just about clip the side of the general's unit, but it's actually moved just out of their arc of fire. We're going to spin the unit round to get them back into range. Meanwhile, the other unit just running across the entire map, escaping from those pikes to make sure that no melee engagements happen. Again, the enemy's general seems to be dodging our arc of fire there, but then gets in really close and finally commits to that melee. Now this I was quite worried about. The enemy's general is a heavy cavalry unit, they're pretty decent in melee, but they have already taken damage, and of course we do have bayonets, giving our men that extra edge against the enemy in combat since they are a cavalry unit. So that's fantastic, and things actually seem to go okay. We start bringing down those guards, and our objective of course is to bring down the general himself. And eventually we do get the man, which is excellent news, with most of his unit dead as well. It's just a case of finishing them off. So the loss of the general isn't going to have a massive effect on the battle because it doesn't seem to make a big change in the morale. Even the guards just fight on. The pikes don't really care about it. They're still confident as they chase my other militia across the battlefield. So we're going to try and finish off the rest of these guards. They actually almost get finished off, but then my men start running away for some reason. I'm trying to order them to go back in and finish them off, but as I make these attack orders, my men just start running off to the side there. Don't 100% know what they're doing, probably following that one horseman who's running away and just leaving the rest behind. A bit awkward, but in the end we finish them off, and I actually bring the other militia unit right around the town to come and link up with that militia unit victorious over the general. because this means we can do a very useful strategy. We can have the enemy's pikes constantly chase one of my units, while the other unit takes cheeky shots at them. As you can see, I've got a nice volley on them there using that tactic. The pikemen have switched target, now chasing the unit that fired at them, so the unit that was being chased before is going to turn around and fire on the enemy, or at least that's what I'm ordering them to do. It doesn't always work out like that, because giving your men firing orders tends to make them do crazy things, like they have done here, forming this very crazy looking formation. They're actually trying to reform facing the wrong direction. Don't know what they're doing there, so I'm going to tell them to manually reform facing the enemy and hope they just fire at will. So basically, this sort of thing I can just do for as much as I want. The enemy are too slow to catch up with me, so I can just keep doing it, keep running away, getting cheeky volleys. I've killed about 100 of the pikes so far, as you can see. Still running away, the enemy getting close there. I need to make sure I don't get pinned against the red line of death at the edge of the map. But overall, it's relatively easy to escape from these pikes. So we just did this until the end of the battle. I wasn't killing the enemy very fast, and you can see in the top right, the time limit's basically running out. And I thought, well, I might as well just play out the time limit so that I can win this battle. You see, I haven't really killed many more of those pikes. Their militia's volleys are so inaccurate, and it's so dangerous to let the enemy get close and then do the volley, that really this tactic, although meaning I don't get killed, doesn't really do much damage to the enemy either. The enemy are wavering though, as you can see, so I was hoping they might just leave without me having to shoot all of them, but so far it wasn't happening. Trying to maneuver there to get around the enemy. The enemy pikes kind of glitched out towards the end of the battle. You can see they're literally just standing there now. They actually stopped chasing me, which was great, so I could just stand and get continued shots at them. My units messed up as well. Some of these guys standing in the way of my own firing line and just chilling, and then suddenly this happens. Close defeat. It turns out that in interception battles, you're not the defender. I thought I was the defender in the fight because the enemy came out to attack me as I was moving, but I guess I technically still counted as the attacker. So by not defeating those pikes, I've actually lost the battle.
Il l'appelle Voss. C'est sûr qu'il était pas présent durant l'invasion hollandaise, mais quand nos amis de Savoie sont arrivés, il est apparu de nulle part, pas même de son armée. Je l'ai observé parler à ses soldats hollandais. Il avait une langue de vipère et n'a pas cligné des yeux face à la confusion qu'il a causée pour devenir leur chef. Mais ils l'ont accepté, et quand l'heure du combat est arrivée, il était au front, calme, sans aucune peur, comme si les batailles étaient une simple histoire qu'il se devait de composer. Maintenant, écoutez ça. J'ai ouï dire que l'armée espagnole à Bruxelles a été vaincue par une poignée de volontaires. Il n'y a aucun doute que Voss est aussi derrière ça. C'est sûr, je me fous royalement du sort de ces conquérants de mes deux, détrompez-vous. Mais les actes de cet individu, Voss, pour changer le monde.
So there you have it, a close defeat. Really thought I had that one and that I'd get to go on to attack that Spanish industry, but my units are instead forced to retreat. Not very good, but we did inflict pretty big casualties on the enemy in that battle. Their light infantry and cavalry severely damaged, their pikes a little bit damaged too, and denied a general. And I started thinking, maybe I can just get a small party away from Paris to come and take Brussels right now. And I managed to get what looks like half a stack together, but all the units in that half stack are half dead, meaning that actually it's quite weak. So as we come in, it's a balanced engagement between the two forces. The enemy reinforced now by their garrison, massively swelling their numbers, but the fight is now even. So that's fantastic news, and the public order's even good enough that taking into account the town watch bonuses I'll get when I move units out, I can actually leave things stable and throw even more units into the fray over with General Voss in Brussels. So now we've got a pretty nice siege going on. The risk is that Savoy will come up and attack the now weakened Paris, knowing that my units are no longer all there, which the AI tends to be able to do in these situations. So here we are in the next turn, and Savoy are indeed doing that, and that basically forces my hand. I'm going to have to take Brussels and move troops back to Paris this turn so that they can't attack it. Not exactly an enormous deal, of course, because we do have an advantage, so we should be able to do that. And to make it better, I can actually bring back those heroic militia units into the army now to aid in the attack. So now we've got quite a lot of regiments in here, lots of them very damaged, but the balance bar starting to creep onto my side there, pretty useful. Now, before we do that attack, I have some other business this turn to attend to. First of all, Van der Sau is going to be walking up Cuba. Now, I said last time that it probably would have been better for me to actually just land him right next to the settlement rather than trying to be clever and landing him on the docks and walking all the way across. But I've made the commitment now, we're going to make the long journey, and eventually we should take Cuba because there's basically nothing defending it as far as we know. Back in Europe, I spotted some Spanish forces finally. I'd been wondering when I'd see a main force from Spain, and we find them here in Gibraltar facing off against a Moroccan stack, though I don't think they're at war with each other or anything. But the interesting point here is that the Spanish have fleets right next to them, so they could, in one turn, bring that full stack to suddenly arrive in my territories up here in Europe, and we really, really don't want that to happen, and there's a real chance that it will. So what I'm going to do is commit all of my navy in Europe to trying to just blockade Spain inside those ports so they can't sail out and will be forced to walk over land at least to another port to slow down their attacks. So we're going to bring out Alamanda with not our entire fleet, because I'm going to leave a really damaged brig behind there, but most of the ships, and they can luckily in a single turn come right down and come up to these ports. Now, of course, the enemy having two ports means I can't blockade them both, or can I? Because actually, they're so close together that they're in reinforcement range. So if I take my fleet and split it up and blockade both, I still effectively have the fleet unified. If either of the sides was attacked, the entire fleet would take part in the battle. So it's pretty safe to do this. We're going to split up, have both of those fleets blockaded, and now the Spanish are going to find it really hard to come out of there. They do actually have some more ships over here near Italy that could come back in and join the fight, and I think that would be a roughly balanced naval engagement if they did come in, but it's worth risking everything on a naval engagement if it means we get a chance to stop the Spanish main force from moving out, so that's all good. Now moving on, I'm going to try once again to get peace with Savoy. Previously, they will only take peace if I gave them Ceylon, and they make a very similar deal here. They want Ceylon, but this time they're willing to buy it for an extremely small sum. Obviously, not suitable, so that deal is right out the window. So with all the other business of the turn finally concluded, we're going to get to the meat of this turn, which is that we need to take Brussels right now. So I'm initiating the siege assault. The advantage is ours. We have lots of units, but a lot of our units are on the verge of destruction from previous battles. They are, though, quite good in terms of experience, some of these depleted line infantry, so that's good. So in this battle, the main focus is probably going to be the enemy's mortars, because we need to do something about them. A powerful artillery unit that will dominate the battlefield, and of course, has a massive range, so right at the start of the battle we're going to be threatened by them. I've got my men in basically a big long line, very thin because of our lack of actual manpower, and the enemy's mortars are deployed behind barricades at the front of their formation. The fact they've set up those artillery defences is quite good because that limits their arc of fire, which we'll see is useful later on. So as I said, they could fire at us right from the beginning. I am going to do my usual tactic when facing mortars, which is turning and running away, at least for the start of the battle. This time I am the attacker, unlike in previous fights against mortars, which means I can't run away and expect the enemy to actually follow me. We are going to have to attack through their mortar fire unless we can get rid of the mortars. So I'm moving the whole line back for now. I need to move my artillery back as well because that's still in range there. And in fact, the enemy's mortars actually almost destroy one of my artillery pieces with their firing before I manage to get my guys to limber up and get out the way. I think I lose a crew member to one of their shots. Nothing too bad. So now later on, everyone's out the way of the mortars, and I've moved some cavalry up to hide in the forest near the enemy's formation. My plan, of course, is to try and dispatch those mortars before I do anything else. Making that difficult for me is the fact they have cavalry defenses right next to them, which instantly kill your horses if they touch them, and the rest of their army, which seems to be forming up right behind the enemy. I am going to be able to make use of the fact the enemy's constantly forming up all over the place and moving their units around, because it means they're not going to have as quick reaction time when it comes to firing. So my first move was to try and sneak up on the enemy's flank. You can see I'm cancelling that right away. The enemy spotted my cav and instantly started moving units to face off against those forests so that I couldn't sneak in behind the enemy's mortars and quickly run across the face of the enemy's army or anything. So that wasn't going to work. My cavalry had to get out of there. But there was another way to do this, which I quickly realised, which is because these mortars are basically isolated out in front of the line and the barricades are stopping their line of sight from allowing them to fire sideways. They have to fire forwards when they're in these artillery defences. I can run right out in front of them and only be in their arc of fire right at the last minute, and mortars actually have a minimum range, so if I run in really close, they won't be able to fire at me at all. And that is exactly what happens. You can see I run out right in front of them, and they just don't react because they can't fire at units that have suddenly come into the line of sight so close. So we're going to jump over the barricade and just start cutting them down. No problem for these two units of cav to wipe them out, and we even managed to avoid touching the cavalry defences there, so no horses lost unnecessarily to that. The enemy, of course, are going to react. They're going to bring their army up to try and get some guns on those horsemen. This unit here, messing around with reforming, it could have fired then, but it didn't. They've got a few light infantry on the hill there firing down at me, but with so many of them dead, thanks to my militia in the previous battle, that's not going to do much, and we are able to finish off the entire mortar team. So now my cavalry are going to bug out of there and try and get all the way back to my line. Suddenly we've gained a nice advantage in terms of range and artillery. That's the signal, although he shouldn't have bothered. We can see the dead Spanish from here. That colonel is too pleased with himself. He forgets if we'd gone with his plan of attacking their flank, he would probably be dead. Remind me to discipline him once we're done here. For now, we continue as I had planned. Unplug the guns and give them a few warning shots. If they run, the colonel will have a chance to redeem himself against them. If they attack us, then we'll do this the hard way. Send word to the line. I want them at full readiness. I order all troops to consume their full day's ration within the next 4 minutes. Won't need any running for this one, and I don't want a single weak arm on a barrel. We'll eat whatever food we find on their dead later. With the enemy's long-range capabilities now destroyed, we can just sit here on our hill with our demi-cannons and point them in the general direction of the enemy, and we don't even have to fire them. That's enough to prompt the enemy into making a move. So while my cavalry rush away from their lines are going to advance towards my position, now wanting to take out those demi-cannons, knowing that they're sitting under the demi-cannons' range. So that's great for me. They're going to march across the battlefield. They didn't quite come in lined up with me, so I was able to outflank them on the left side here with some extra units, so that is good news. The rest of the line is now going to get ready for a line battle. They have their pikemen positioned on their left flank, and that's a bit of a shame because I had all these cavalry ready to storm the end of their line, but with the pikemen there, that's going to be more dangerous, so we can't rush in hastily. I am going to be able to rush in hastily on the other side where the line battle is just beginning. I'm totally exposed there, just militia on the end, line battling with my line infantry, which will go badly to start with. I'm also totally outflanking them with extra line infantry there. So the battle's starting properly, but already we're seeing rout among the enemy. Here, right in the center, an enemy unit of militia routing away. They're going to come back pretty soon, but it shows the enemy's morale is very poor if a single volley is enough to rout the enemy. So here comes a cavalry attack on their right side. Nothing they can do here, totally swamping that tiny unit of light infantry and this whole unit of militia with two squads of my own cav, two companies of my own cav, I should say. There's that unit coming back from routing, but it's coming back into a line that's already falling apart. Even on the left side here, their pikemen failed to engage, falling back before they reached the lines, and all the rest of the men around them doing the same. So things are looking pretty great. This battle has lasted about 30 seconds in terms of the actual engagement of troops, and the enemy are just not willing to fight, so it's time for me to send in the horsemen and really punch them while they're down. The horsemen get in amongst all of those routing units and are starting to just annihilate all of their troops. We've got lots of horsemen in this army, five or so companies, so we're just going to overwhelm the routing units. Everyone getting killed everywhere, their general falls amongst this chaos. The enemy army is pretty much destroyed now, just waiting for the last units to go from wavering to routing. So, they're finished off. This means we've ended this battle with pretty much no actual fighting. Maybe the enemy got off one or two volleys with some of their frontline units, but as you can see from the losses, they didn't really do anything to us, losing fewer than 100 troops, destroying almost 2,000 of theirs, and perhaps more importantly, we've now captured Brussels, because this was a settlement battle technically. Some of our horse units there losing no men and getting hundreds of kills. Fantastic performance from the army of General Voss, the Spanish humiliated in this battle, totally slaughtered. So the settlement is indeed now going to be ours. Fantastic news. This improves the security of our capital Amsterdam and of course links up our newly captured region of France. So we have a complete land empire here in Europe and can walk between our territories just fine. Now, the first thing I'm going to do after capturing it is leave, because of course I need to get back to Paris to make sure Savoy can't sneakily attack it with their army there. So Vos is going to take a whole bunch of cavalry and a few imp back, and I realised I could actually probably afford to take more back, and I should, because the army at Paris is super unbalanced in favour of Cav, so I'll send a few more men over. We don't need all those troops in Brussels. So in the end turn sequence, Savoy attack the university near Paris, but they don't attack the settlement itself, which was a wise move from them. We've just had an election, so all of our ministers have changed around. We've got a pretty good selection of ministers, which is lucky. Lots of guys with tons of stars. Gives us tons of passive bonuses all over the place. I can choose to kick people out and try and get new guys elected in, but I'm pretty happy with this cabinet for doing our home ruling, so we'll keep them at it. So now we have the Savoy standing right outside Paris after their attack on the university. And of course, perhaps they didn't really think this through, because I can repair that university for virtually no money, and now my army is right next to them, so I can just make an attack against this army. We might not be at full strength, but neither are they, so we have a very big advantage on the balance bar. I'm going to auto resolve that. Losses, somewhat hefty actually, not too different to the enemy's losses. One unit in the enemy's army survives, which is so annoying. Really bad when this happens in Empire and Napoleon, because those single units don't scatter the wind or anything. They'll keep fighting, so they'll keep raiding me if I don't leave them. But I noticed I was fine to actually leave Paris, even with no troops inside it, so I could just send the whole army down south. It almost looked like I couldn't reach them, but I just about could, so we can auto-resolve that last unit out of existence. Savoy's army is now finally crushed, and through those two battles, Vos has gained some more abilities as a general, increasing his command, so that's all useful. So now, Paris is pretty much secure. There's still that Spanish army down in southern Spain, but it's still stuck by my blockade. They're not attempting to lift it. So right now, I think we're not really under any main threats in Europe, so that's great news. Nassau continues his little adventure through Cuba. Really annoyingly, he can't quite reach the settlement. He stops right outside it. I thought I might be able to drop the guns and just go and attack with my infantry, or even just my cavalry to initiate a battle, but it wasn't happening for some reason. Although it does give you extra movement points, as you can just about see, by selecting only the other units. For some reason, they can't continue on to make the attack, even though it kind of looks like they can. Who knows? We'll have to wait another turn. We gather today not only to make rule over our United Provinces, but our foreign provinces, both near and far. We rule over the Spanish of Flanders, who oppressed and exploited our people for so long. We rule over the French, sick with arrogance at their past success, and now bent to the will of a nation ruled by its people, its fair God, and the force of logic. In the Americas, we rule over untold numbers of people, cultured and primitive, and untold tons of shipping, an empire that grows daily by the fine direction of one Corbus Lodovix, I understand. But the East India Company has grown stagnant and weak, not becoming of the power our nation now wields. Therefore, I declare the goal of this cabinet is to revitalize our eastern interests, lest others make it impossible. Moving on to Spain's turn, we see some naval action. Not against us, luckily. They attack the Barbary States and lose, so that's going to further hamper their ability to break out of my blockade. Excellent news. Now moving to the Americas, where I'm moving a few ships about here. I'm moving militia about mostly, in order to occupy all of the ports to make sure no naval surprises can come along. So there we see me putting troops in that port. And that one ship we saw move over just now is also carrying a squad of militia. They want to occupy the port of the Spanish here in Cuba. I'm not going to do it now because they'll damage it because it's an enemy port. But what I'll do is once I've actually captured it, just dump those militia in to guard it from then on. As for the settlement itself, they're totally overpowered by Nassau. I offered them surrender. I thought they might even take it because we had such an advantage, but they actually didn't. So I'll just auto-resolve those guys out of existence. And there we go. We've taken Cuba. Fantastic capture, one of the richest islands, probably the richest island we've taken so far, which is very nice. Lots of plantations on it. I'm going to immediately start replenishing the army as well. So now I have to decide what to do next. I thought I might as well actually just storm on and find some more Spanish holdings to capture. The Spanish territory is to the north, Florida, going up into North America. So first I'm going to dump those militia into the port, as I said, and now with the sloop who were carrying them, I'm going to move them around to sit right next to where Van Nassau is, so that I can go and get in that boat if I need to, and just sail out somewhere. Now, the question will be whether the public order can tolerate me moving the whole army out, and it looked like I could. I can leave nobody in the province and just untax it, which isn't too bad in terms of money. I only have to do that for a few turns as well. And if I do that, I can basically blitzkrieg. I can move Nassau to attack Spain immediately. I was reluctant, though, to put my entire army in one sloop, because, of course, if there was a sudden attack or it got intercepted by an enemy navy while it was moving, then that would be really dangerous. So instead, we're going to bring Calumba and the main fleet to transport the army. That does mean I have to stop raiding the Spanish, which actually costs me a couple of thousand per turn, so that's a massive shame, but I'm willing to pay that price for the security. Turns out, of course, I didn't need to do that, because as we sail up to Florida, we see the Spanish have a few regiments just standing around there, quite far from the settlement, not able to do anything. In fact, the port is actually to the northwest, so they're not walking towards the port, no idea what they're doing down there, and the settlement is pretty much undefended. So what I'm going to do is put Nassau onto the land in between the two Spanish forces there. If either of them, even both of them, attack me, I think I'll win, and if they don't, then we can overpower the settlement next turn, so that's fantastic. Back in Europe, General Voss is going to bring his army back towards Paris. He actually couldn't quite reach it, unfortunately. And I'm also considering moving all of the professional infantry from Brussels over to Paris so that we have our army together, basically, in Paris to respond to any threats from there. Luckily, the public order was okay, so I was able to move those regiments over. So now they're all basically going to replenish. These armies, of course, have been fighting for quite a long time without being replenished. So now we're going to try and get all of our troops back to full strength now that we're making a steady profit. And that profit is massively supplemented by the fact we can finally tax Paris, making us almost 4,000 a turn from that single region. We're suddenly going to get quite rich quite fast if we can maintain the peace for a while now. So that's fantastic news. We're still, of course, at war with Savoy. They are building up more forces, but we can build up faster than them, and we're already stronger than them, so it's not a huge concern. So I'm now going to the diplomacy table. I've got a few deals I want to make. I'm trying to get trade with Persia, and they say they'll take it if I give them the technology social contract. I thought that was probably okay. They're only a small faction, unlikely to make any particularly dangerous use of that technology, so that's all fine. I also noticed I wasn't trading with the 13 colonies, and I thought I would be able to since they're a protectorate of my ally Britain. They wanted me to pay a fairly hefty amount for the right to trade. I wasn't against the idea of paying, because I'll make lots off this trade, thousands a turn. And actually, we end up with this deal. They want me to give them flintlock cannons. So, a little bit of a bad deal because I'm giving a military technology to my potential future enemy there in North America. But I do take it in order to get the money. Savoy refusing more peace deals as usual. They refuse to become my protectorate. So, I tried offering them a more normal peace deal, saying, how about peace and trade? A very fair arrangement that's going to benefit both sides there, especially considering that I'm more powerful than them and they've lost the war so far. And again, they don't take it. Just incredibly bad diplomacy from Savoy, so they'll have to remain our enemy. One of my top priorities now is going to be to start using all of the money that I'm making to upgrade all of my colonies, to massively increase the amount of money we can get out of them. We've got lots of plantations and mines all over the place, which if I can just get enough money, I can upgrade to massively increase my export capacity and tax income. I also need to upgrade a lot of the government buildings as well to further enhance tax income. So now, in the start of the next turn, the Spanish in Florida did absolutely nothing, so that's perfect for me. I just walked over to their settlement. I considered fighting this, but in the end, thought I might as well auto-resolve. It's only a tiny army, and we take the settlement easily. So there we go, getting more level ups for Nassau as well. He's getting very good right now. We've taken Florida, our first territory on the North American mainland. I was looking at Nassau, you can see he's really good, got tons of great traits, but he's also really old, which is worth taking into consideration. We might not be able to make use of his extremely good leadership for much longer. So I'm going to replenish this army, and now just sit in the settlement and see if the Spanish react. There are more Spanish forces to the north in this settlement that's worth absolutely nothing, but they seem to be weird raiding forces, not a proper army there. They've got more territory in the Cherokee lands, but overall, I'm not worried.
The fact that Dutch had decentralized control of their empire was a key factor in their domination of Spanish America. While careful Spanish commanders awaited royal approval for their plans, the Dutch forces could strike any targets they learned of and report back later. With it taking months for messages to reach America from Europe, this was clearly the superior arrangement. General Van Nassau of the West India Company hit island after island, even making an audacious landing in Florida to seize the Spanish administration before they had any idea what was happening. Suddenly, although the Spanish at home had not heard of it yet, The Spanish holdings in the west were all but gone, along with the vast majority of their American armed forces. So thanks for watching. I'll be trying to force an end to my wars both with Spain and Savoy in the next episode of Sinews of War.